one might expect people would have a strong incentive to learn how to predict when and where a major earthquake is going to strike next. The cost in life and property that could be saved is huge. Pretty powerful reasons to leave no stone unturned in the search for predictive factors, right? Well, maybe. Scientists are starting to see the correlation between sunspots and earthquakes. Naturally, the first impulse is to use sunspot data to make predictions. NASA and the European Geosciences Union have put their stamp of approval on this sunspot hypothesis. In a nutshell, it suggests that certain changes in the Sun-Earth environment affect the magnetic field of the Earth. This can trigger earthquakes in earthquake-prone areas, though it's not clear how such a trigger might work. In the Journal of Scientific Exploration, seen here, there's a good report that talks about the realistic problems facing any geophysicist attempting to understand quakes. The paper is titled, Rocks That Crackle and Sparkle and Glow, Strange Pre-Earthquake Phenomena, by Dr. Friedemann T. Freund, a professor in the Department of Physics over at San Jose State University, and a senior researcher at NASA's Ames Research Center. The doctor writes, quote, many strange phenomena precede large earthquakes. Some of them have been reported for centuries, even millennia. The list is long and diverse. Bulging of the Earth's surface, changing well water levels, ground-hugging fog, low-frequency electromagnetic emission, earthquake lights from ridges and mountaintops, magnetic field anomalies up to 0.5 of the Earth's dipole field, temperature anomalies by several degrees over wide areas as seen in satellite images, changes in the plasma density of the ionosphere, and strange animal behavior. Because it seems nearly impossible to imagine that such diverse phenomena could have a common physical cause, there's great confusion and even greater controversy. End quote. Next, Freund shines a light on the bull in the china shop. Quote, based on the reported laboratory results of electrical measurements, no mechanism seems to exist that could account for the generation of those large currents in the Earth's crust, which are needed to explain the strong EM signals and magnetic anomalies that have been documented before some earthquakes. Unfortunately, when a set of observations cannot be explained within the framework of existing knowledge, the tendency is not to believe the observation. Therefore, a general malaise has taken root in the geophysical community when it comes to the many reported non-seismic and non-geodesic pre-earthquake phenomena. There seems to be no bona fide physical process by which electric currents of sufficient magnitude could be generated in crustal rocks. End quote. Now, normally, rock is a good insulator. Freund makes a heroic attempt to explain all this phenomena in terms of rocks acting like a P-type semiconducting material when it's under stress. That is, semiconductive material that lets electrons flow, but only in one direction. Here's an example of this subsurface conduction. The emission of positive ions coming off the Earth's surface may act as a nuclei for the ground-hugging fog that sometimes occurs before an earthquake. Now, it's true there isn't much surface potential, somewhere in the 1 to 2 volt range, but the accompanying electric field spread across a thin surface layer can reach hundreds of thousands of volts per centimeter, enough to cause coronal discharges, or earthquake lights. Thermal anomalies seen from space before quakes could have something to do with the emission of infrared light, where that semiconductor charge recombines at the surface. As for the strange animal behavior, well, good chance the presence of positive ions in the air could explain it. As Freund says, this theory places an explanation in the realm of semiconductor physics, which means that getting a bunch of geoscientists to decide what is and is not peer-review relevant might not be a great plan. It's like calling a plumber when you're wondering why the power went out. And then he goes on to say, quote, the peer-review system often creates near-insurmountable hurdles against the publication of data that seems contrary to long-held beliefs. End quote. Yeah, you think? At least we aren't the only ones that have to put up with these guys. Well, Freund went on to identify a source of charge in stressed rocks, one that experts knew wasn't possible until he proved that it was. Quote, once fully told and understood, the story of P-holes is basically so simple that many mainstream geoscientists are left to wonder why it's taken so long for them to be discovered. If they are so ubiquitous, as they appear to be, Why did pee holes go unnoticed for over 100 years? End quote. Let me explain. The P-type semiconductor, or P-hole, uses the kinds of atoms that have three grabby hands for attaching, unlike the normal, more pure variety that have four. This empty spot leaves a pathway for electrons to flow, and that's what he means by P-hole. Personally, I'd have gone with a different name, but what can I say? Anyway, in the face of evidence and a big fat what took you so long to figure out this basic stuff, the mainstream splits. Some just blow the data off like an ostrich outwitting danger by popping his head into a hole in the ground, while others question some parts of the hypothesis, such as how these positive holes manage to flow from deep in the earth all the way to the surface to collect without being reabsorbed. The fact is, though, earthquake lights are a thing, and something is making them happen. This is a very, very hard problem, says Chris Marone, who works on the physics of rock deformation at Pennsylvania State University in University Park, a problem that involves maintaining charge over surprisingly large distances. And speaking of surprises to absolutely no one who watches this channel, the discovery of these powerful charge carriers through the Earth's crust wasn't met with cheers and profound understanding that at last the electrical nature of earthquakes may unlock our ability to predict them and save lives. Nope. As usual, it was met with hostility and opposition, a pattern we've been watching play out for a long, long time. Froon closes his paper with a quote from the philosopher Arthur Schopenhauer. Quote, "All truth passes through three stages. First, it is ridiculed. Second, it is violently opposed. And third, it is accepted as being self-evident." End quote. Now consider this. If not even Freund can get these knuckleheads in academia to admit something as easily demonstrated as this, how are we ever going to wake them up to the fact that Earth is a charged body in an electric universe? Now let's pencil in the electric force to Freund's paper and figure out what happens. The main part the mainstream doesn't get about the link between sunspots and earthquakes is that the same electric discharges causing sunspots also affect Earth's ionosphere. Like we discussed with dust devils and whirlwinds, the ionosphere is basically one of the plates of a capacitor, while the Earth is the second plate. Changes of voltage on one plate are going to induce the movement of charge on the other. Unlike a capacitor, the Earth also has charge distributed in the rock beneath its surface. Now, if there's a case where that rock becomes semiconductive due to stress, the chance for a sudden electrical breakdown can occur. And that means there's no reason not to expect the same kind of process to occur underground that gives us atmospheric lightning. Now, that might be limited in a small tremor, but when we're talking about the big quakes, the entire circuit could get involved. From deep underground through the atmosphere and into the ionosphere. Think about it. Kind of explains those massive disturbances in the ionosphere we see above major earthquakes, doesn't it? Now this seems pretty open and shut. The source of the current has already been solved thanks to Freund. It's all those pee holes in the Earth. The link between sunspots and the ionosphere is already known, so simply by adding one and one you get the answer. Earthquakes are caused by subterranean lightning. Seismic waves are the rumble of underground thunder. The energy released is comparable to atomic bombs, but only a fraction of that needs to come from the release of strain in the rocks. Most of it comes from Earth's stored-up internal electrical energy. Unfortunately, we aren't completely reliant on the blind to get the word out. This issue of the IEEE journal, Spectrum, features an article based on Froon's work that looks at ways of predicting earthquakes. A published paper that the mainstream will pretend isn't relevant and thus ignore. Looks like, once again, real science is being done by electrical engineers. Now, as a bonus, we find another striking bit of theoretical symmetry between terrestrial earthquakes and a strange detail we've noted about comets. Being rocky bodies like the Earth and in the same electrical environment of the solar system, comets often carry significant electrical charge distributed throughout the nucleus. However, unlike the Earth, conducting plasma is in direct contact with the nucleus, so that electrical discharges reach down to the surface where they are concentrated into cathode jets, seen blazing off the comet like a giant tail. Difference is that the rock on a comet isn't under mechanical stress like the Earth's plates, so it doesn't have the pee holes. In other words, it's still a good insulator. Now that said, the increasing loss of charge from the surface of the comet as it rockets toward the sun starts to create some serious electrical stress on the rock. And if there's a subsurface discharge, a comet can and will suffer comet quakes. Some of these suckers are strong enough to shake rocks right off the surface into space. Now take a moment to sit back and appreciate the interconnected processes we see all across the solar system. One force to explain whirlwinds, canyon formation, cosmic circuits, cosmic jets, and on and on. It's getting sillier and sillier to deny the obvious fact that the electric force plays a leading role in our universe. If the mainstream can't find their pee holes, then by God, let's go around them. This episode commemorates 1 year since the passing of a giant. There's a paradigm shift coming. And Wal Thornhill's brilliant work may be, more than any other single person, the catalyst for this very much-needed change. His was a voice of reason inside the bureaucratic mess of the standard model theoretical sciences. And if we listen and build on what he taught us, you know, the human race may yet get through these crazy, crazy times in history and start doing science based on a foundation of beautiful, simple, electrically charged reality.